And welcome to another week of 72 Pin Connector. With us this week, we have Adam Jordan.
Hello, welcome.
Tom Webster.
Praise the sun.
And myself, Eric Fine. How are you guys doing this week?
I'm doing good.
Pretty good. How are you doing?
It's going well. I'm actually fully healthy for a week, and I love it.
Fully healthy for a week.
Yeah, for like the last 2 weeks, been going through like a box of tissues every 2 days. Damn nose. It's like a fucking water faucet. It just turns on.
The allergies, or if you had a cold?
Kind of a cold thing.
No.
Yeah.
It sounds like you need to praise the sun more.
I do need to praise the sun more. I mean, you could see I'm getting pale as shit. I'm blending into the damn background.
Nobody ever said you need to praise the sun less.
You see, the more we praise it, the more active it is, the warmer our world's getting. It's not really global warming. It's just hearing our praise and warming us the fuck up.
Yeah, see? Yeah. I'm really trying to set humanity free by praising the sun as much as possible.
Come to us, Ra. Come to us. So what have you guys been up to this week? Getting much games in, or?
Not a lot, but I did get some in.
I've gotten a decent amount.
Yeah. So I played some Rocket League, as usual. Not a lot, actually. I've probably played less than I have in a long time. But I have been playing a lot of Lee Chess with you guys, which you are aware of, but our listeners are not. So LeeChess.org to play chess with your friends or random people. It's a lot of fun.
You guys
all
will
free,
hear us plug
all the time.
You are going to hear plugs for this for probably the next month on the show. Because we have all been.
This game has aged very well. For a 19th century game, it plays just as great as it did when it came out.
I like the patches they made to the original version, though. So the Mad Queen patch was very good. And then the Kingside Castling patch, I think, was just excellent. Really helps in the opening of the game. But the devs have been fairly silent since they released it. I mean, what? The last major revision came 200 years ago, 250 years ago, and there hasn't been a patch since. I mean, some people say it's perfect. I'm thinking, especially in an esport like this, it makes the game a little bit stale.
Yeah, just it's a little rough around the edges sometimes, you know. You have to wait 5 hours for someone to take a move, you know, but it's a good game still.
It really is a great game. Like, for real, it's a really good game. There's so much strategy involved. It really gets your brain working.
With Lee Chess, they give you the ability to do chess variants. So there's stuff like King of the Hill, there's a race mode, and these sound weird when it comes to chess, right? Like, it's chess, how can you make variants? But you can do a whole lot with that engine. It's gaming
with
talk.
The player pieces.
Yes,
with the chess engine. Assets, you might say.
Ooh.
Oh man. Okay, but the anti chess is really good, and Lee Chess gives you the ability to play a ton of these variants with your friends whenever you want. I know each of us regularly has 3 or 4 games going at any one time, and yes. Check it out, because even if you have a remote passing interest in chess, it's just a lot of fun. And they've got a fantastic Android app, so if you wanted to load it up, go for it. Also, it's free.
So Adam's been playing chess. Tom, outside of chess, what have you been doing?
Well, was that your whole list, Adam? Did you have any awesome Rocket League stories to share?
No, not really.
Okay.
Not all really right. Anything too crazy.
I have a question for you.
I didn't play a lot. Yeah.
Has there been an official announcement on when season 3 will conclude?
Yes. Early April.
So they released
the announcement for the new season. They're overhauling the ranks again. So they're taking it back to the kind of how they had season one set up with bronze, silver, and gold. But it's kind of the, it kind of goes along with all the other games, bronze, silver, gold, diamond, platinum, and then they have the a champion tier and then a separate grand champion on top of that. So they're expanding the ranks.
Okay, that's good. Get a little bit more stratification in there amongst the upper echelon of Rocket League pros.
Yeah, because the grand champion rank is such a huge skill gap within just that one rank between like the top level of the grand champion ranks now and then the people who just got to grand champion. There's a drastic difference.
I'm sorry, I can't hear your elitist complaints. I'm stuck in the potato tiers where I'm a decent player playing people who still don't know how to fly. They need to stratify more at the lower end as well, because that gets very bad, and that's where a lot of toxic comes from.
Yeah.
I play Dota.
So yeah, I mean, that's really good. They're going to help segregate those out a little more. This is an instance where segregation is good.
But at the same time, it just depends on what changes they make to the matchmaking system. Because when it searches for a match, it's not searching for the rank icon, it's searching for the MMR value. So it might not even really change anything except for what visual rank you get displayed. You still might get the same matchups. But, you know, obviously we're hoping that they've, as long as this season has gone on, this season has been longer than any other season. So, and it's because they were trying to make changes to the ranking system.
Pretty much they knew they had an imperfect system. They had let us roll around in the muck on an imperfect system while they try to fix it.
Well, yeah, they wouldn't want to release a new season and still not have any improvements to the system.
And it's not like they can change the MMR, you know, tiers in the middle of a season. So it's either
they did a recalibration last season. They did a recalibration because the ranks were so skewed towards the lower end. They basically changed the threshold of MMR values respective ranks.
Never mind. All of the rules and everything sane in this world has gone out the window. This is truly the weird timeline.
No, but they're doing their best, and they're doing a good job at communicating to the community.
That's good.
They're very transparent. They give us numbers, all kinds of stuff. They post on Reddit, on threads, answering questions. All kinds of stuff. So, but yeah, season four, early April. That should be fun.
This week, I have played a bunch of games, actually. So, I did finish, just like I said I was going to last week, I finished Super Metroid early this week. About 8 hours to get through, give or take. Absolutely wonderful game. Fantastic. It controls well, not as tight as Super Metroid or Zero Mission. But, you know, it's on the Super Nintendo. It's older. The 8-bit dough NES controller worked great. Check out our hardware review on YouTube. Super Metroid, absolutely a wonderful game. Fun romp. Definitely go check that out under, you know, any system. If you can play it on the regular Super Nintendo, go for it. It's available on Virtual Console everywhere. So, yeah. I started Hyper Light Drifter. It's so good.
That seems hesitant. Yeah,
I don't know how to feel about it.
Think of that. That game's got a lot of praise from what I've heard, but watching you play it just didn't seem something that would grab me.
It's because I hampered myself. So when I first started out the game, I was like, okay, cool. I'm going to load this game. I use a Kami operating system called Linux, and, you know, it's got a bunch of warts, and it's not really production ready. So I plugged in my controller, expecting things to work, because I'm an idiot, and the controller just didn't work with that game. So what I ended up doing is I was like, okay, that's fine. I'll play with mouse and keyboard, which Hyper Light Drifter does work with a mouse and keyboard, but it controls like absolute dog shit. The game is entirely different. I did get the controller to work this morning with like loading some libraries that the game is referencing in before the game to sort of shim them in there before the game loads. So it loads the specific libraries I'm calling and makes the controller work with that. It's fucking weird and annoying. But I've got it all tied now into a bash script, so I can just run that and launch my game. But with the controller, it's an entirely different game. It's smooth as butter. It plays well. It feels great. Besides the controls, the game is graphically absolutely beautiful. It is gorgeous.
Yeah, you know, that everyone... game reminds me of Fez, Born, or Met with Risk of Rain. I still hold that that is exactly what that damn game looks like. And in a good way, it's like colorful. The psychedelics. Yeah.
It's not, you know, these nine shades of gray and 20 shades of brown. It's a beautiful game. And the sound design and soundtrack is phenomenal.
The soundtrack is great. I did listen to the soundtrack. The same guy actually did the soundtrack to Fez as well. And the movie It Follows. If you've seen the movie It Follows, it's got a really cool soundtrack too.
I have not. I'm only, I want to say, an hour and a half into the game, so not that far. I have no idea what's going on. The game does seem very challenging, though. Zelda-esque mixed with Dark Souls is the feeling I'm getting right now. Not as punishing, but, you know, the game does expect you to be halfway competent. It's not going to hold your hand. It's not going to say, oh, you only got hit 27 times. There's one enemy early on in, like, the first underground-ish dungeon area that I was in, and it can get, you know, 2-3 hits on you before it just splatters you across the ground. The game isn't, it won't baby you, which is a nice change of pace. You actually have to be skilled. On the other hand, if you're not using a controller, you will get your ass handed to you all the time, and it won't feel like your fault. The mouse and keyboard controls are just not up to par, but the game wasn't designed to be played that way. Designed to be controller first,
which is really weird though, because I mean that game was a was it just PC or was it actually like an Xbox Arcade kind of thing too?
You know, I don't remember. It was a Kickstarter project, if I remember correctly, but I don't know what their targeted platforms were.
All right.
So I did start Alien Isolation. I'm probably an hour and a half, maybe hour into that game. Adam saw me play some last night. And I'm not sure how I feel about it. On one hand, the game is absolutely stunning in its aesthetics. I mean, we're talking late 70s, early 80s, computer terminals, interface, everything from when it tells you, hey, this button is to crawl, this button is for flashlight. It shows up in the blocky, like, late 70s era terminal text on the bottom of your screen. It's, you know, the crisp high resolution buttons you're used to seeing. Everything in that game, from the menus to the sounds, it feels perfect and era appropriate.
It just looks to me like a beautiful rendition of Dead Space. Like, Dead Space to me didn't look
the gameplay. It's not that good. Dirty. No,
that's what I'm saying. Dead Space didn't look pretty to me, where this looks very well polished, very smooth. And just to me, it felt a lot like Dead Space watching. Like, to me.
Oh, visually. Maybe it's in space. A little bit. it's not as bloody, it's not gory.
Yeah,
it's cleaner, but it does have. I could see it sharing, you know, some of Dead Space's sort of darker architecture. Yeah, you know, when you're inside the ship, that
you said sort of you said not as gory. The one clip I saw was some dude like getting his abdomen impaled.
Okay, to be fair, in Dead Space, the entire objective of the game is to tear the arms and legs off of creatures around you. Alien Isolation offers you the ability to run faster, hide, and oh god shit, run. Those are your abilities. At least the ones I've seen so far.
So
I wanted to pick that game up so bad when it first came out, and I never got to it. But I remember, Adam, I think you had it, didn't you?
Yeah, I have it. I never did beat it, but I did get probably halfway through it. Something like that. How many hours do I have on that game? I loved what I played of it.
The tension of it. Like the feel that you have to wait while this thing is looking for you.
And the AI is pretty good. Like, you can't, there's no like surveillance paths that it takes, and you're just waiting on it to go to this room, and then it turns this way, and then it goes to that room. Like, it's completely, it's completely randomized. I've got about 12 hours in the game.
The one big graphical complaint I have about the game is every character literally, and you can tell they might have been going for this because of the way the reflection maps are mapped the character models, but it looks like every character is perpetually sweaty. It's really weird. Like, any light that shines on a character, yeah, it looks like they're just wet. It looks like they just stepped out of a fully running shower. It's really off-putting, and it's honestly, it's a thing that keeps dragging me out of the experience more and more. When so I started this game, I was looking, I was like, okay, there's people, they look fucking weird, that's fine. I'm going to see them for the beginning of the game, and then never again. I had the wrong expectations. I had the wrong expectations.
The dripping wet makes me think of BioShock. Everything in that game just feels like it's saturated with water.
But it fits in that game. In this, you've got this nice, crisp, clean space station that looks like it's from a sci-fi novel written in 1950s America. Like, you look at the cover of the book, and it's one of the screenshots from the game. And then you've got this guy that just looks wet and sweaty and gross. You're just like, the fuck, man? Come on. You live in the future. Clean yourself up. But even beyond that, so I get to this space station and I'm wandering around and it's dark and there's stuff creaking everywhere and shit's happening and there's alarms and klaxons. I'm freaking out at this point. Nothing has happened in the game to make me freak out, but I'm freaking out. I'm all alone. I'm in a darkened space station. It's scary. And then there are humans. It absolutely, I know why they did it. I know it's a thematic choice. I know it adds more gameplay systems, but the tension got ratcheted up so high, and then it's like, oh no, by the way, you're not the only person on the station, there are other people, and there's going to be gameplay objectives around other humans. It took me out of the experience. It would be like, I don't even know. I was expecting to be, you know, the lone person trying to escape whatever this thing is trying to eat me, and I'm not.
Well, you're still going to be by yourself.
Right.
Well, actually, Adam, I was going to ask you, if it's not a spoiler, if it's a spoiler, say you can't really describe it, but the game, when it was advertised, made it feel like it's you versus it, that there is nothing else there. I mean, do these AIs eventually die off and it is you, or is it just this, you get sent off on missions alone kind of thing?
From what I'm seeing, there's bandits and shit that you have to avoid.
Yeah, there's the occasional bandit. You've never have an ally with you when you have to play gameplay. So there are people in the cutscenes, but you are still by yourself on every alien encounter.
And I realize that I'm nitpicking at this point, but the fact that I know that there are other humans on the station and they're roaming around, it just
makes me...
they're
gonna die.
Well, even if they are gonna, it makes me feel better knowing that I'm not the only person there. It really toned down the horror for me. It took the edge off. And
yeah, I was gonna say that.
I don't know if I'm like a social butterfly, but you know, it really took the edge off knowing that I'm not completely alone.
I don't like that. I think that the game would feel better if you were alone. Like, yeah, sure, start with people. After a mission into, people start dying off, and eventually it's just you and this other person. You come back and like they got a fucking spike through their chest.
Yeah. Well, I think there's parts where somebody gets caught behind the door and you're on the other side and you can't get back to them, that kind of thing. Or you get sent off on a mission by yourself. I mean, it's still, you still feel very, very isolated in that aspect. Tom, how far did you get? How many enemy types have you encountered?
Just the big guy.
Just the alien and then the bandits?
Yeah.
Okay.
See, I'm literally at the very beginning of the game. Okay.
How did you feel the first time you saw that alien, the first encounter with the alien?
Honestly, a little bit underwhelmed.
Really?
So, this isn't really a spoiler. It happens in the first hour of the game. But, you know, you're walking along with Dude Man, and Dude Man gets, like, stabbed through the chest by an alien, and I was expecting it to happen, but it didn't jar me as much because it happens in a cutscene. It doesn't happen in gameplay. So I'm not controlling. I'm not surprised. I'm just sitting there watching a horror movie at this point. Mm-hmm. I'm just like, this guy's going to die. Oh, look, that guy died. Cool. Check mark. Dude dies. Got it. And then it's like, oh, hey, now you got to run. And the alien's gone. It's not like it's, you know, in front of you still with like dude man hanging off its tentacle or anything. It's just like, oh, it disappeared. Now you've got to go run away. I'm like, okay, cool. I'm going to find a corner. Horror games freak me out. Silent Hill and Eternal Darkness scared me shitless. This game just makes me wish it were something more.
Huh.
That's my first impression. I might grow to like the game, but my initial impressions are very middling. There are some things it does excellent. There are some things it just really falls flat on.
It sounds like you're still fairly early on, though.
Oh, it's very early. Yeah. I'm barely an hour, maybe hour and a half in.
But the gameplay is so tense. When you take a game like Outlast, a big problem with that game was it's a lot of chase scenes. So like you get seen and the music ramps up, your heart rate goes up and you start running away, but you run faster than all the other enemies in the game. So you just run around the corner, run around another corner, shut a door, hide behind something, wait for them to go away, and then you continue where you left off. An alien, when the alien sees you and you try to take off running, you're already dead. You can't run away from it. It's faster than you. It is absolutely faster than you in every way. So anytime you get spotted by the alien, it's more or less a pretty much guaranteed death.
That's awesome. Because that gives more that gives more intensity to the fear of you turn the corner and see it. It's like, oh, fuck, get away before it notices. Yeah.
Right.
Well, there's a couple different ways to do fear, and I would like one of our group games to be, if I can throw this out during our live podcast, I would like one of our group games to be Metroid Fusion at some point, which has some of the best, most tense horror movies I've ever encountered in most games, and it's a Game Boy game. And they did something really special with the SAX, which is an enemy you encounter very early on in the game that kind of stalks you through the whole experience.
Yes, I remember that because I played that. Right? When I hated it.
There are certain parts in Metroid Fusion where you're sitting there, you're hidden, and like the soundtrack is perfect, the sound effects are perfect. I don't want to spoil anything for anyone, but you're just praying. You're sitting there sweating and praying, please God, no, don't find me. And you know, if it takes one more step, it's going to find you. And then it walks out of the room. You're like, oh, Jesus. One of the best pants shitting moments. And it's in a Game Boy fucking Advance game.
All I always hear is I love Metroid. That's all I ever hear out of you.
I'm gonna make it one of our group games. I'm gonna have to. It's just so good, and it has aged well. And like I said before, you know, it's one of the like two games I've beaten over 20 times.
Wow.
So, and that's not an exaggeration. Like I've got like a 26, I think, is my most recent run. But praise the sun, I've been playing some more Dark Souls this week. And I have posted a video. It looks like shit. And frankly, I'm playing like shit. But I have posted a video on the 72-Pin Connector YouTube channel if you would like to see me fight like the Bell Gargoyle demon thing and his friend, which freaked me out the first time I was playing. So, you know, big boss. It's my big time, you know, fighting something on my own, more or less, in the best Dark Souls way. So, you know, I keep getting killed. I finally start getting hits on this guy. I start getting it together, knock his health bar about down to half, and then flames erupt behind me. I'm like, oh God, what the fuck is going on? Did I step on a trap? No, there's a second one that pops in. His buddy decides to join the fight. So now you have to defeat two when the first one was kicking your ass so hard. And then like I'm down to no health. I'm like, God, there's no way. There's absolutely no way. So then you repeat that, you know, 10 deaths or so. And then you finally figure out a way to beat them both. And it's just a great feeling. But I'm going to tell you guys a Dark Souls story. So I've been playing, I've been, you know, trying to find these items that will make me powerful enough to take on this boss that I'm at now. And I go into spooky woods, and they're pretty spooky because they're spooky woods. I'm in this weird forest area. There's a little temple, and I'm walking up these steps. It's a tight corridor, steps going all the way up. And it really feels like, you know, only good things happen in this place. So I get to the top, and there's this giant stone knight that's literally twice my size with a broadsword that's about 1.5 meters tall. I'm like, oh, fuck. I'm like, okay, I've got this. He's big and slow. He could kill me in like 2 hits. So I'm going to go backtrack, go out of this little temple area, run around the woods and make him chase me, and then run up the stairs because I know there's an item in there that I need to grab. So I start running down the stairs, and there's another one that followed him. So as the first one started coming up, the second one's behind me, and they're trying to sandwich me in the corridor. I've got to bait the guy to attack me to one side, roll around him, and eventually I grab my item and end up falling off a cliff and killing myself. I figured that would be the better way to die than being impaled. But it's...
more respect. Some great... take it into your own hands.
Exactly. Yeah. It's just great, great gameplay. It has still never felt cheap to me. Every time I die, it's because I've gotten greedy, I'm going too fast, or I'm just not thinking, and I'm running through an area. I absolutely love it. It's difficult, it's punishing, but it's never difficult. Unfair.
I've played all of 30 minutes of Dark Souls.
I won't be touching it, but I'll be getting Neo. That's launching next month, and it's Team Ninja. It's a little faster pace than Dark Souls, still has the RPG elements. Mm-hmm. Looks really, really fucking good. Because I'm a big fan of theirs. I've just never really played much of the Souls.
Did you ever play, speaking of Team Ninja, did you ever play Ninja Gaiden when it got relaunched on the Xbox?
Yes. That was one of the hardest games fucking ever. There was a Citadel boss.
Yes, it was.
That me and my buddy were stuck on for probably 5-6 hours. And we only beat her because we eventually had one of the times after we died, because we was going through this level, really low health, save, didn't realize it was right before the boss fight. No potions, no shit, right before the boss. So we ended up after 6 hours, went like balls to the wall aggression with no blocking, no rolling, no nothing. And that was the only way we beat her. It almost felt like a glitch. That game is brutal.
Dark Souls also lets you, there's a little bit of life philosophy coming straight from Crew 72 right here. Dark Souls allows players to leave messages on the ground. I got one of the best messages today, right before the boss that keeps wrecking my shit. And it just said, beware life. It's like, oh, okay. Yeah, that's some good old Dark Souls philosophy for you. Just beware. If you're alive, beware.
How many people leave notes in Dark Souls that are just intentionally misleading?
A lot. There's right before that note, there was another note that said, great weapon ahead. And then you cross through the barrier, and this guy wrecks your
nothing
shit.
Nothing but death.
Yeah. There's one guy next to the edge of an endless cliff, or a bottomless pit, said, try jumping. Like, thanks.
Yeah, I don't think so.
I appreciate that.
Thanks, guy. There's always those guys.
And there's always one true fact about Dark Souls. If you're alive, you're going to die.
Yeah. There's a lot of jokers in Dark Souls, too. There's this this blacksmith that helps you out a lot. And he's, you know, this big, giant, buff guy who's shirtless. I mean, he looks like a Norse blacksmith with a big-ass hammer, hammering shit and making stuff. And they left a message that said, beware, amazing chest. It's like, okay.
Yay,
thanks, humor. Guys. But yeah, I'm liking Dark Souls, and I'm going to play more of it. I think Hyper Light Drifter, I'm going to play a little bit next week, maybe get back into Alien Isolation. We'll see. But that's all I've got.
Eric?
Yeah, so same old Rocket League, nothing new. Binding of Isaac, actually picked that up recently, started playing a little bit more of that. I actually haven't done the DLC.
I was about to say, did you get Afterbirth Plus?
I need to. I really need to. But yeah, I just started playing it some more. Still really love that game. It's just a fun pickup game, especially green mode. I really find myself gravitating towards green mode.
Yeah, it's a great game to just go back to.
What is green mode? I'm not an Isaac fanatic.
Greed mode.
Greed. I think it's a green mode, like easy mode.
So unlike regular Isaac, you have a floor. Every floor will have an item room, at least one item room, and at least one boss room, unless it's an XL and then you'll get two of both. This room, or this mode, each floor has a free item room, a locked item room, and a shop. And these are all three rooms off of this big-ass main room you start in. And then this shop will always have two 15-coin items, two trinkets, or no, one trinket, a health and a heart, or a key and a heart. The big main room you're in has a switch. You press it. Spikes come up around it, and you can press it again. But what that starts is a wave of enemies. And you have to fight through 10 waves of enemies, and then the spikes go down, and you can re-enter the shop. Every wave of enemy, you get 3 coins. So what happens is, you fight through 10, you're going to get 30 coins. You can buy a key to get the item room, and then you can go back in and buy an item out of the shop. You hit that button again, you spawn one boss. 30 seconds later, or after you kill it, you spawn another boss. Once that's done, floor's cleared, you go to the next, rinse, lather, repeat.
Yeah,
it's all the way in.
Yeah, and it's got this kind of balance of, like, you can press the button again to stop the enemies from spawning, but then you get less coins when you get them all through.
Okay.
And then I think the last boss wave is also optional. Yeah, the boss wave at the end is optional too, isn't it?
No. There's is how it, after the two boss waves, you can hit the button again for one more harder boss that unlocks a devil or angel room.
Okay.
So you can actually fight up to 3 bosses. Yeah.
Hmm.
But that's old game, still playing it a lot. Started another playthrough on Factorio. I have one factory where I'm already sitting like 80 hours deep. So I started another one because I wanted to get the achievement where you don't craft anything more than 111 items by hand. So it's a slow burn, but I think I'm going to get it this time. It's only going to take me probably about 20 more hours. God, that game takes forever, but it's so good. Only 20 more. Such a good game, though. Then I was also doing a little bit of lead chess like you guys were. Don't Starve. I know Adam's played it. Tom, you ever done Don't Starve?
Yeah.
I've watched Renee play it a whole lot. And for those of you not in the know, Renee is my waifu. So she has played a metric shit ton. So I've seen a lot of the game, but I've never played it myself.
So I reinstalled it, got one of my buddies to reinstall it. We started running together last night. That started as a beta. They've added a lot. I think Don't Starve Together has more content now than Don't Starve.
Yeah. Unless the multiplayer added a lot to the game. Because I didn't like the game single player that much. But then when we played, I was having a lot of fun with it.
Yeah, I think we went like 2 full years on it. Like game wise, not 700 and some odd days, but actual like
we didn't in the game 2 years.
We are veterans.
It's like Dota levels of gameplay.
But yeah, so that game. What happened was I really, really wanted to play some Stardew Valley. A buddy of mine was like, you know, I think I still have this key. Try it. So I'm like, fuck yes, we can get Stardew Valley. Put in the key; it's already been redeemed. So I'm like, god damn it, I don't want to buy it yet. I'll wait till it's on sale, but what the hell's going to scratch the itch? Then I'm like, you know what? Don't Starve. So started that back up. But there is one new game that I've been playing, and it's Halo 2 beta. They have a free beta right now, or Halo Wars 2, sorry.
Halo 2 beta.
Halo Wars 2 beta. It's a blitz mode, which is it's a card-based RTS. Rather than having to have factories to produce things, you get energy over time. And you always have 4 cards up. You play a card, but a card costs so much energy to play. Once you play that card, you randomly draw another card from your deck. and it's not a a run-out deck. Once you play a card, it gets shuffled back into your deck. So your energy gets up, you can start playing cards, and that's how you amass your army. And occasionally there'll be resource drops on the map, where if you capture the resource drop, you get more resource per second, and then you also get a big boost. But it's not something that stays on the map you have to control. It's you fetch it, you get it, you have it. And then there's three control points on the map that are centrally focused, and that's what the game name of the game is. It's domination. You only get points when you have more control points than the other team, and it's a race to 200. So far, it's fun. It's not your Command & Conquer level, StarCraft level RTS. This is a console-friendly RTS. That said, Blitz was enjoyable. It does feel like this is the type of game where higher level people will wreck lower level people, because after you play a game, and you'll get decks and you'll open up decks, and that's how you fill it's how you get cards to fill your deck. If you get duplicates, it levels up the card and gives it slight bonuses. So the higher level you get, the better the cards you have, the better the units you have. So this is a game variant where inherently you get better just by being a higher level. Not because you've become better, but because you actually have better shit. So I'm going to be interested to see how they segregate the player base, because you have to keep the higher levels away from low level.
That could really, really wreck the community very quickly.
And to be fair, the player base for the game like that is going to be pretty small to begin with.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good news is this is just one variation. There is still the campaign, which Halo Wars 1 campaign was great. If you like the lore of Halo, it did great things for the lore of Halo. And then it will have a typical RTS game where you build factories, produce units, have resources. It will have that mode too. It's just Blitz is their version of Warzone for Halo 5. Only it's more card-based than even Warzone was. It's fun. It was free. It was worth a check. I don't know if I'll be picking the game up. I do like the game. But we'll see. If they run any specials on it, I will. Especially the play-only is nice. I can go down, play it on the TV. The TV's in use. I come up here, play it on the computer. That's really fucking nifty.
Yeah.
So I think that's about it for what we've been playing, but I think Adam has a little tidbit for us on a game that actually recently launched. And if you look at our background, is also what our background is.
Yeah, Resident Evil 7. I was so pumped for this game too. And it actually seems like it's getting really good reviews. And a lot of people are saying, like, obviously, a lot of people are probably hesitant about the first person viewpoint. Obviously, that's the biggest change. But a lot of people are saying it's really effective, and it still feels like a Resident Evil game.
See, I've heard that it brought back a lot of stuff from the earlier Resident Evils, while story-wise kind of branching out.
Yeah, the story doesn't... I don't think it has much to do with the old stories. But the game has VR support, PSVR exclusive for a year. And the VR is getting great reviews too. So
really pisses me off though.
I'm thrilled. It's something in VR that is catching on, and it's a big AAA title. This is huge for VR. They needed this.
It pisses me off because I want it right now. Right, and I want it on the Vive.
Absolutely. But it's good because it's showing people that VR isn't just a gimmick. Like you can make a full fledged gaming experience and enhance it with VR. So there's actually a tracking website on ResidentEvil.net. So when people start the game up on PlayStation, there's an option to send data for them for tracking stats and stuff. So there are, of the people that have agreed to this, there's 700,000 people playing, and 67,000 of those people have played with VR. That's almost 10%. Almost 10% of people have been playing with VR.
That's good numbers.
Yeah.
There's actually a reviewer for IGN that has went as far to say that VR is the way you need to play the game.
I've heard the same thing. Mm-hmm. what I've heard from some of the people, gamer viewers and the like, and industry folk that have played the game in and out of VR, they say that VR is really the only way you should be playing this game, because it is that good. They did say that they said it's odd because it's not like, you know, in most games you can sit down and power through, but I noticed this in Serious Sam, and I can only imagine it would be worse in Resident Evil, but in VR stuff really gets to you really quickly because it's very, very immersive. So they said, you know, they could play for an hour and a half, 2 hours at a time before they just had to walk away for a couple hours and then come back to it. Because it was very, very intense. Not like physically straining, but physically draining.
Right.
Because they're walking around, you know, terrified out of their minds inside of a haunted house.
Right. That being said, I've heard that the first part of the game is a little more horror, but later on in the game, it gets to feel more like the old Resident Evil games do. So there, you do have weapons. You can defend yourself.
And I always imagine that would be the case. I don't expect Resident Evil to go full Silent Hill.
Right.
Where they say, hey, lead pipe, good luck.
And it's also, I've heard it went very hard back to ammo conservation of original Res, where when you miss a shot, you almost want to restart because, damn it, I just wasted a bullet.
Oh, and I'm sure a lot of Resident the enemies are bullet sponges too.
Yeah.
If it follows the old Resident Evil mentality, you know, fighting is literally your last resort. You run away from everything. You don't use bullets until you're halfway through the game.
Probably, but we'll see. No.
I might wait to pick this up purely because I think I want my first playthrough to be VR exclusive. So I'm going to have to wait for that to hit the Vive, because I'm not going to buy a PS4 Pro just for this game.
I'm not going to wait that long. Yeah. I can't wait a year to play this game.
You would be waiting spending $800 if you want to play PSVR.
Well, yeah.
Right. Yeah. I mean, you're talking Oculus kind of entry point, Oculus Vive.
Yeah, so I'm probably going to wait because I do want my first playthrough to be, you know, VR exclusive. That said, if it's on sale, I might go ahead and grab it, but I don't know if I'm going to want to play through it multiple times after going through it once or twice.
Well, there's a Madhouse difficulty that unlocks after you beat it the first time, so you can play it again harder
in VR.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
Which changes more than just like making the enemies harder. Like, I think it actually changes spawn locations of enemies and that kind of stuff too. So it'll feel like a different playthrough.
Good.
That's something that was always kind of boring about when you unlock higher difficulties, when it just turns them into more of a bullet sponge. It's like, this really is just making me shoot better, making me pick up more ammo.
Yeah.
And then there was one more tidbit of news. It's nothing big. I thought was interesting. Microsoft, back in December, they ran a Gears of War 4. It's PC and Xbox One. The cooperative game modes like Horde have always been crossplay. And for a week in December, they opened crossplay for social matchmaking, for actual like playing against each other. And traditionally, across the board, we've always heard the rhetoric and we've always seen the results of PC gamers wreck console gamers. It's just how it goes. Well, it looks like on Gears, it's not how it went. In fact, they found that the matches were close enough during that week that they were willing to open up the social matchmaking permanently crossplay. So I think this is going to be an interesting case study.
I'm always in support of crossplay. Always.
I am, but you know, just like all the previous studies suggested, you know, if the console players are chronically having a shitty, shitty time in multiplayer because, you know, a third of the player base is on PC, you don't want to ruin multiplayer for all of your console players like that. That makes up the majority of your player base.
Well, and that's what was interesting about this.
I think getting more data on this problem, because it is such a big problem and it is such a potential gold mine. that if shows data to the contrary, where they say, no, they really get along and it's close enough that it doesn't really matter, that's great. I would love to see more crossplay stuff. I just worry about segmenting the audience.
Is there matchmaking in place, though, that puts you in matches with similarly skilled opponents anyway? So even if they would skew towards the bottom of the skill level, they would still, it wouldn't really affect their gameplay experience.
I guess it all depends, because it's social. Because social, it probably depends on the game. Is your social get you in as quick as possible? I mean, it all just varies. I would assume it'd
be more lenient.
I'd really like to see... it's Microsoft, and they won't release the data for this, but I would love to see like a paper or presentation come out at, you know, IGF or GDC, where they say, hey, here's what we did, here's the data we found, and here, you guys can use this in the rest of your game design, because we think this data is valid. Please go try to prove our point. I think that would help out, you know, the games industry at large, but we'll see if Microsoft does it. They're not, you know, they're not strangers to sharing information. They just don't do it as regularly as some other studios.
One thing I'm curious about, you mentioned that the data for the console players not being significantly worse than the PC players. How much of that do you think is because Gears of War has always been a console title?
Yeah, if you've got like six PC players.
Because and if you put all the console CSGO players up against the PC people.
Well, but then I was just about to say, this is also a different type of shooter. This is not your traditional first-person shooter. This is a cover-based third-person shooter where it does play a lot like a first. A lot of the aiming, because I played through it on PC. This is my first experience of it on a PC. I mean, sometimes whipping around quicker was better, but honestly, the way these guns shoot, they're not ungodly precise. I don't think there's a huge advantage to the mouse. Because with CSGO, one bullet to the head, you're done. Precision is everything.
Hugely reliant on precision.
So the mouse would help. I think this game is actually a type of game where, yeah, you might get a slight edge on rotational speeds if someone doesn't turn it up on a controller, but there's not a whole lot of precision weapons. Like, extreme precision weapons. I mean, they have some, but not like one-shot head done kind of thing.
Good. But so, yeah, that'll be interesting.
That is all for the news, because it's early in the year, and everyone's just waiting for the Switch. Everyone. So,
let's move on to our group topic.
Yes.
We have a group topic this week. Open world.
You can go ahead.
Open worlds. Do you guys like open worlds?
No.
No, it's terrible.
They suck.
I like
the worst thing that's happened to the worst thing that's happened to the video game world genre. Worst thing.
Since Ubisoft themselves.
Ah, hey now.
An easy part to start this off. What's your favorite open world game? If you had to pick one.
Oh man.
This
one's gonna be fairly easy for me. This one's fairly easy for me. I'm gonna have to say Grand Theft Auto V. By far, the most stuff is always happening in the world. The world is big enough and interesting enough on its own that you want to explore it, not necessarily just to see the stuff, but just to see the world. Even Easter eggs that don't lead anywhere, haven't led anywhere, like the Mount Chiliad mystery, just stupid little things. I mean, even with decompiling the game on PC, it took PC gamers and in Reddit at large, you know, over a year to find Bigfoot. There's just so much to the game, and all of it feels cohesive. It feels like a complete package. It honestly feels like one of the best made games I have played in years.
Nice.
You see, GTAs are good. They're great games. Rockstar, they know what the fuck they're doing. Red Dead, one of my favorites. But they're all... people love those. They really do. But to me, something that I liked about open worlds was stories advancing without you being there. Shadow of Mordor. That game was fantastic. It was blend of open world and then also their nemesis system layered on top of it. where you have these ranks of orcs that you can try to get your people up the rank of that will kill each other off in the world without you being there. Or you can go there and start shit between two of them and get them to fight while you're not there. So that's, I really like that about the world. The world was evolving without you having to be there to do it. It was just constantly going, and the world was really gritty looking. It was huge. There was another areas you can get to. It didn't have the GTA like glimmer to it. It was really gritty and dark, but it's just, I really enjoyed the kind of different things that it brought.
I could see that. Definitely.
So what say you, Adam?
Does the witness count? Because that would be mine. I don't know. Maybe, I'd say
open world is such a like fluid genre.
Yeah, because that's true.
It's, can I go to my objectives in any order? Does it have to require stuff happening in the world? Does it have to require me being there for stuff to happen?
Right.
Well, see, I don't even view it as a genre.
We're talking, well, yeah. It's something a game does or does not have, but
yeah, it's just a map style.
As far as what people think of traditional open world games, my favorites are probably, I played a lot of San Andreas, Grand Theft Auto San Andreas. I loved Fallout 3.
That was great.
I don't know that I can pick a favorite because these aren't usually the types of games I play.
Pop out.
So I think one of the things that we did want to discuss is, you know, does back in the day, especially back around the era of GTA 3, GTA Vice City, San Andreas, it seemed that everyone and their mother was building their games to have an open world just because they could, because that was something they were expected to do. Even games that it didn't really work in, that you weren't supposed to have an open world, that it really hampered all of your design decisions, they had to have one because consumers, well, they thought consumers expected that checkbox of, yes, it's an open world.
Right.
We've seen a lot of decent games, a lot of bad games. One game that I think has got a lot of good and a lot of bad to it. Did you guys ever play Spider-Man 2?
I loved that game. I thought that game was fun.
I did. I don't remember a lot about it, but I knew I had played it.
But let me ask you this. What was fun about it?
Well, the web slinging was probably the most enjoyable thing. That was probably the funnest way to ever get around in a game. That was such a fun looking motion.
But what else did you do in that game? So I'm thinking of Spider-Man 2. I remember a whole lot of repetitive, shitty missions that failed half the time because like they started on a timer and you might be heading the wrong direction. You might get there in time. You might not. But the game never compensated for that. So a lot of the times you'd show up to the mission and you would have already failed it.
Ooh.
It's like, okay, well, this sucks. And it doesn't like do anything to penalize you. It's just like, hey, yeah, they robbed a bank, or this guy fell to his death, or yeah, whatever. Like 80 grandmas just died. Whatever, man. It's cool. You're Spider-Man. Just swing away. And the web-slinging, just traversing the world, was a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
Everything they put in the game to do, aside from travel, I thought was absolute dog shit. I think they literally needed an excuse for the web slinging, so they made it an open world.
Did you ever play Prototype?
I was going to bring up Prototype.
Prototype took Spider-Man 2?
It took
Spider-Man 2 and built it out better.
It was Xbox version of Infamous. They kind of released close to the same time.
That's right. No, I never played that. I did play Infamous.
It was actually pretty good. Like, it was a great game. I had a lot of fun with it.
I was torn between my favorite open world game with Shadow of Mordor and Prototype. I love Prototype because there was a lot of story to it that you had to get by killing random people on the street. Like, they would show up on your map.
That's interesting.
And it was optional.
It was optional.
You didn't have to.
They would show up on your map, and you got the choice of, do I finish this mission, or do I diverge and try to catch this son of a bitch really quick? Me and my buddy were actually on a playthrough where we had probably about 70% of it. It's called the Web of Intrigue. And it was great because you start to find out all this stuff behind the story. that they never used. And again, the sequel had nothing to do with the Web of Intrigue, and it was so disappointing. But Prototype was amazing.
Speaking of Prototype, did you guys ever play Infamous? Because I played a ton of Infamous.
Never even touched it.
So it's a game where something happens and you can throw lightning or something. You're like some guy becoming a superhero. It honestly feels like one of the most generic games I've played. The open world wasn't... It was really dull. Hardly anything happened in the world itself. Yeah, there's always the stupid little side missions that pop up, but none of them were particularly interesting. None of them had really anything to do with the story, which is one thing I think GTA 5 did really well, which I'll get to later. But with Infamous, a lot of the level design and mission design was, okay, we want you to do this thing. We're going to have you traverse this path throughout the city. And they used it as sort of, instead of building levels for your game, they said, we'll just take this chunk of the city and make that your level. Sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. Sometimes it was just arbitrarily hard because the section they mapped out for you to do didn't really work for traversal that well. And then beyond that, they had, because everyone had to have a moral choice system, they had, well, you can kill a bunch of people, then you'll turn red and you can get these weird cool powers. Or you can save a bunch of kittens and you turn blue and you get the shitty powers. And so, me being the dumbass, I decided to save all the kittens and turn blue.
So you brought up morals.
I didn't like it. Yeah.
Morals in open world automatically drags me one way. That's Fable. And that game was open world, but it really was more of like a Zelda Ocarina of Time open world, and that really disappointed
me. I really have a lot of issues calling Fable open world, especially because Molyneux is a fucking liar. Guy, he's done some great shit, but he is a goddamn liar. Because he gets really excited about shit, he spouts off, and then none of it ever comes to fruition.
So, that game was amazing. Fable was amazing, I hated every bit of it. I loved it, but it was promised to be Morrowind, and it was not Morrowind.
Right. So what I expected, what I was promised is, it's an RPG. You can do anything. You can be anyone. Your character can be a hero, and you can have a bunch of kids, and you can die, and then you can take over as one of those kids and have a giant lineage of hero grandchildren that are responsible for slaying all the dragons in the world, and then maybe something happens and everyone knows you, and then you're written about in books, and it's a completely open world, and if you wanted to get rid of all that and be a shop guy, you can run a shop. I'm just like, oh my god, it's the everything RPG. It's an RPG where literally any choice exists. And, you know, Teenager Tom was really excited because Teenager Tom has absolutely no perspective on reality and how video games are made at this time. I just thought...
Because Teenager Tom has never... He's never been disappointed with Duke Nukem Forever. So he doesn't know the false promises.
Right. See, like my last big open world game was Ocarina of Time, which really satisfied just about everything. I just wish I had more of it. So... You know, this guy comes along in Game Informer promising me, hey, it's Ocarina of Time, except you can do anything, and it's as big as humanly possible. I freak out. I buy Fable, day one, and I play it, and I get to the end. I'm like, it's got, like, track levels that are fairly small, and I can either be Chicken Kicker, and when I kick chickens, people call me Chicken Kicker, or I cannot do that. Fable wasn't a bad game. It just was absolutely not what it was promised.
I have one problem with what you just said. You're calling Ocarina of Time open world, but you're not considering Fable open world?
That's what I thought of as open world. Today, I wouldn't call it open world at all. I'd call it, you know, it's a big space you can explore. I'd call it similar to like a world map in a Final Fantasy game, but it is not open world. I wouldn't consider Final Fantasy an open world game.
If you consider Ocarina, I think you have to consider Fable and open world. They are the same thing. It's just Ocarina of Time has a larger little open, like, field.
That's what I'm saying. I'm saying that I did consider it an open world. I don't consider Ocarina an open world today. Not at all. I consider Final Fantasy and most standard JRPGs and Ocarina of Time on the same level as not an open world, sort of just like a world map. Area
Okay, to me, I was going to have to call you a fanboy if you was about to be all on Zelda. I was going to call you out on that bullshit.
No, I wouldn't call it open world. I think one of the main drivers of what makes an open world game for me is to have the world be a living, breathing place, not just a place where sometimes objectives take place. In GTA 5, for instance, the world and the random events in the world actually contribute to the story. There are side characters, there's side missions, there's stuff where you can learn about the character's past or drive them in a different direction in their future, or actually make meaningful contributions to the world and characters around you through literally purely random side missions that sometimes happen and sometimes don't. And that's one of the things that really contributes, is having the world feel like a living, breathing place and not just a large room.
Yeah.
Rockstar is great at that. Rockstar is fantastic at that. Red Dead Redemption, I remember you're just riding, and then there's this burglar thing where this guy stole my shit, so they have you go shoot him. And then half the time you find out he really didn't steal shit and he was running away from the actual guy.
Oh, Red Dead was so good at that. It was so good.
I can't wait.
It also gave you a lot to do outside of even missions, because you had the whole hunting aspect of it.
Yes, you did.
And the Grand Theft Auto games are just as good at this. There's all kinds of little... You can have fun not doing side quests, not doing the main mission line, and just messing around in your open world sandbox. Like, you can have fun just that.
My one beef with GTA... I was going to say, real quick, one beef with GTA, and it's honestly something I put on the downsides of open worlds, is this ambition that they try to give the players to do stuff that's just not feasible. Like in GTA 3, get all 100 boxes, or I think it was 4, shoot all 100 of these pigeons. It's like, no one's going to fucking do that, and they're going to try to do that and actually start to... Yes, they're going to start hating the game because they're trying to do that.
Adam said what it is. It's not for you. There are in generally accepted game design theories, there are 4 major types of players that I won't go into. Look up the extra credits episode. It delves into this, but one of those types of players are the completionists. They're the guys that get every star and every coin in Super Mario Brothers. They're the guys that go through GTA and they will fucking hunt those pigeons down and murder them callously just to get the achievement. They're the guys with gamer scores in the bazillions, because that's their whole objective, is to get the check marks.
I used to be a score hunter. I mean, I'm the guy who got fucking Airbender because you can 1,000-point it in 5 minutes. I'm the guy that had the 1750 score on
Halo. You were that guy.
I'm the guy that did 1750 on Halo because I wanted to get everything on Halo. I understand the completionist, but theirs are masochistic. There is no way you find those without looking up a guy. It would take you years to find those without a guy.
I agree with that.
And that kind of brings up another point about open world games, kind of the opposite of the last one. Yeah, we were just talking about how, you know, it's bad if you have a big open world with nothing to do in it. But I think it's just as bad if you have a big open world and too much to do in it. Because it can be such a huge distraction, you don't actually finish the game. You're constantly bombarded by this new blip on the radar. Oh, well, I have to go see what that is. And it's some little dumb side quest thing. And then, there's like these million dots all over the map. That's all something. And I think it's easy to get caught up in that and not actually finish like the main story of the game.
Anyone who is checklist oriented is going to get messed up with those, because it's just too much, and they'll set the game away and not play anymore because they get overwhelmed. There's actually people on some of the podcasts I listen to that are like that.
Yes. I do want to delve into the series as a whole, but the worst offender I've seen in that particular thing where they throw too much shit on the map at once is Saints Row 4. Saints Row 4, when you load up that mini-map, it's just plastered with everything. Every little collectible, it shows up on the map. But that guy that I wanted a clean map. I didn't care about the objectives. I didn't care about getting all the shit. I just wanted that shit off the map. So I went and I collected all the fucking shit. And it took forever. And it wasn't... I didn't have a bad time. I wasn't having a good time, necessarily. But, oh my god, it was just... It was so dense, but none of it mattered. None of it was engaging. None of it had anything to do with the story. It didn't further character development or you know, my powers or anything meaningful, anything fun in the game. It was just there to be there.
Saints Row the Fourth was one of the few times I felt burnt for paying $60 for a game. Such a letdown after the third. Such a letdown.
I will completely agree with that. I didn't hate Saints Row the Fourth, but I went into it expecting an expansion pack, and that's what I got.
Yeah.
Now, Saints Row the Third, I would like to cover that because, Irk, you and I played Saints Row 3 really heavily. When we went through that on co-op, I know I've played through that game probably 3 or 4 times, and I love Saints Row the Third. It is ridiculous in all the right ways. If you want GTA, but just filled with the worst crass humor that makes no sense whatsoever, like, we're talking like the lowest dregs of comedy, like Family Guy levels of comedy here. But it's just, at the end of the day, the game exists purely to be fun. Saints Row is your game.
It's the GTA creator of Rockstar was stoned out of their minds and then tried to make GTA. Yeah,
they turned the wackiness meter all the way up.
It's hilarious. It's fun. I mean, it's the only open world game where you can walk around slapping civilians with a giant dildo.
The shark gun.
Literally a perfect game. The shark gun. The fucking dubstep gun. Oh my god. That was amazing. Okay, so Saints Row the Third, I thought, had... On one hand, it had... The side missions and stuff had nothing to do with the story, but the side missions were varied enough in that game where you can do racing, you can catch yourself on fire, you can do insurance fraud by throwing yourself in front of cars, you can shoot people out of cannons. There's, like, a ton of weird, wacky shit to do in that game. And it's all got a rating system, so you're encouraged to perfect each of these side missions as you approach them. But it had enough to do, and it was varied enough that nothing ever felt like a slog in the world. The world felt complete and put together appropriately.
And it was just so good co-op. It was almost like GTA 4, how the second player can just jump in seamlessly. The game just doesn't pick up. You just keep going. I remember there was days where we would just fuck with the cops. Where we would just do nothing but just fuck with cops. And that was amazing on that game.
Yeah.
It was a good game. One game I do want to discuss, and I don't know if you guys have played it or not, but I want to talk about L.A. Noire, because it's sort of the antithesis to everything that's got the Rockstar logo on it.
I've never played it.
I never did play that, no.
Really? Okay. So, L.A. Noire is an open world set in early L.A. I want to say 1950s, 1940s, maybe. Early L.A. And it is, they try to be as historically accurate as possible. Now, one thing to mention here is it was made by, I believe, Team Bondi. It was developed by them. It wasn't developed directly by Rockstar. Rockstar just published it. This game had a fucking huge budget. So, they made this giant open world, and they put levels into it. Not like, hey, we're going to do this infamous thing where we segment off pieces and that's where you go and you have to go there. No, like, literally, you complete a mission and you go to the next level and complete a mission. And it just so happens that you're using the open world to drive to the next place you have to be. Other than that, the open world serves absolutely no purpose whatsoever. It's just there. It just exists. It's empty, hardly anything happens. There's side missions, but they suck and they're all samey. I don't know why an open world exists in that game at all. At all. It serves no purpose.
I heard the same for Mafia 3, where the only point in the open world is so they can slip some dialogue in while you're driving to your next mission.
Yeah,
and that was pretty much the only purpose.
Here's the thing about L.A. Noire. You don't have to drive. When you approach a car, you can say to your partner, because you're a cop, you can say, hey, you can drive. And you just sit there. and you get a nice extended cutscene with some dialogue while he's driving through the open world, which never opens up.
Defeats the whole purpose.
Yeah, I mean, it I guess makes for some okay, I can't even call it organic levels, because, I mean, yeah, you do some car chases and you run through open town LA and, you know, some guy you have to chase across a rooftop. I guess that's all right, but there's no reason that had to be an open world. It could have been levels.
Right.
In the way the story and the missions are segmented and sort of set pieced together, it literally serves no purpose whatsoever. It's, I don't know why an open world was there. This seems like a game that sort of lost its vision halfway through development.
It's an open world because everything's supposed to be open world these days. And it's the same reason why it does. It's no longer a selling point for me. I don't care if your game is open world. Everyone does it. It's been done so many times. What the fuck are you doing that makes me want to be in that open world?
Right. You know what game wasn't open world? Doom.
Mario.
Yeah.
I got into a bloody fist fight. I got into a small argument at work with some gamers, and they said they won't play a game unless it's got like a bunch of branching paths throughout levels or an open world where they can do whatever they want. And I said, you've completely discounted all linear games. I said, yeah, I just don't like it when I play them. Why? I would much rather, I completely agree with Warren Spector when he was talking about Deus Ex. He would much rather have, you know, a city block that's super packed and super dense and has a whole shit ton to do in that tiny little space, or even like an apartment building, a tiny little space, but you're never bored in there, rather than an explorable area the size of the planet, but there's nothing to do.
Yeah, absolutely. I think linear games get a little bit of a bad rap in that regard.
I agree.
I don't hate linear. It's just,
I love
linear. There's no alternative. Now, okay, I'm just drawing the line right here. If you get the choice between doing two different missions, and then it branches right back together, and at the very end you get like a different ending, that's still a linear fucking game to me.
Oh yeah.
When I think non-linear, I mean, you're talking extreme branches that takes you on completely different areas. Like Ogre Battle 64, if you take this battle, it closes off this entire other end of the map that you'll never be able to get to now. That is non-linear to me. Not what's going around today.
But I think games are getting technologically deep enough, and it's taking so much longer to develop because everything is so detailed, that you're not really going to see a whole lot of that. Like, what recent games can you think of that did that at all?
None. I can't think of one offhand.
The last one that had the great illusion of doing that was Mass Effect, and it wasn't perfect at it. It was just really good.
And it was at the very end, it was just the same ending with different dialogue to it.
Which I understand why. And recent documents have come out. Turns out that they did have a completely different ending written, except it accidentally got leaked out and people got their hands on it. So EA demanded that BioWare completely scrap and rewrite the ending of the game.
Right.
That's why it turned out as shitty as it did, is because EA didn't want spoilers out there. They fucked. And I honestly, I don't think the ending of Mass Effect ruined Mass Effect. I played that for the journey, and by God, I got a journey. I got one hell of a space opera out of that. I think one game, probably the biggest open world game right now, literally biggest open world game right now, that has gotten the most flack in recent memory is No Man's Sky. I mean, when you talk about a big open world with literally nothing to do in it, No Man's Sky is the poster boy.
Man,
you're setting me up.
I know you liked it. I know you liked it. You played it for the exploration, but it's an open world game. People expected stuff to happen in the world. They didn't just expect the world to be there, right? But that's what it was.
So I'm the guy who bought the game at $60, telling my coworkers who were all hyped up on it that, listen, there's no way this game meets it. There's no way this game meets it. So I came in 100% expecting them not to do what they said. Because what they said they were doing, honestly, it's fucking impossible. No one has done it. Star Citizen's trying, and we'll find out in 2038 whether or not they pull it off or not. So, honestly, yes, the game was not what they promised. A lot of people hated it for that. The game didn't have a whole lot to do, but I will tell you, when you get to the top-tier planets, because you have a top-tier warp drive, maybe 15% of them have some cool shit on. So, yeah, it's not super common, but there is some cool shit out there you can find. But, yeah, that game got so a lot of shit.
I do want to talk about something Adam brought up, which is open world games that have far too much going on, like settle the fuck down open world game. One game that's actually been doing that to me that I'm having issues even launching the game because there's just so much to just check off the list, but I'm not sure I care enough about the side quests is The Witcher. And while not a typical open world game, I mean, open world sort of in an RPG sense, but not entirely. There's just a shit ton to do. And when you get to a new area, when you get to a new chapter, anyone you talk to, and you, of course, there's like a main mission board, but anyone you talk to just gives you like 75 side quests with a text dump and you know, requirements. Hey, you have to buy this book so you can learn about this monster, so you can kill this thing, so you can get me like super rat pelts, but you didn't know about super rats before, so you have to buy the super rat book, which takes some gold, so you have to do this mission for this guy to get the gold, to buy the book, to kill the rats, to get the pelts, to deliver them, except you can't deliver them to me, because I'm going to tell you have to sell them to Bill, who's on the other side of the place you just came from. Witcher.
Sure, it can get overwhelming.
It's a good game, it's just, holy shit, they give you a lot to do. And I realize it's an RPG, right? This is at least a 60-hour game if you're going into it trying to speedrun. But it's a little overwhelming. It doesn't give you the right tools to manage that. And it feels like busy work a lot of the time. It's got the MMO problem, which, frankly, we could do an entire podcast about MMO open worlds.
Content for the sake of content.
I've heard a lot of really good stuff, though, about Witcher 3. I don't know if they dialed it down, but I mean, Witcher 3, people are loving.
What I've heard about it is that the side quests actually have their own interesting stories, and they feel meaningful. It's not just fetch quests and
go kill this thing. They're a far cry from The Witcher 1.
Yeah, they actually put some effort into them, which is good. That's what you need.
Speaking of that, does that count? Does Far Cry count? Is that an open world game?
I'd say so.
Yeah.
So what Far Cry games have you guys played?
I've just played a little bit of Far Cry 3. That's it.
Okay. I played Far Cry, Far Cry 2, Far Cry 3, Far Cry Blood Dragon. I did not get into 4 because at that point I had been burnt by just too much Far Cry.
I done some Blood Dragon, that was it.
So the first game was really interesting. It had an interesting story behind it. It had actual characters instead of no-name people that you forget about afterwards. And the whole idea, if you've never played a Far Cry game, is Far Cry puts you on this island. It says, hey, by the way, your objective is in this building, right? Kill this dude, steal this stuff, whatever. Your objective is here. Go to this place. And you can walk up to the front door, guns blazing. You'll probably die, but you can try that. You can sneak through the jungle, you can sick monsters after them, you can do a whole lot of things in this whole world. You have the whole world to toy with to meet your objective. Far Cry 2 and beyond really push this, where they say you can approach your objectives from literally any angle. If you wanted to, you know, steal a boat and try to hit a rock and ramp into the base and land on some dude and then use explosive barrels or rocket launchers or something, you could try to do that. If you wanted to send in tigers to kill everyone, you could try to do that too. I loved Far Cry, the original. I did not love Far Cry 2 and beyond. Just because everything felt the same. Everything felt like, hey, there's these guys, you're going to have to steal these diamonds, go infiltrate a base. And that's literally every Far Cry game now is
pretty much,
hey, here's bases, go infiltrate it, which is fun the first couple times, but it does not make for a 40-hour game.
Yeah. So Question for you guys on open worlds. Have you had one where you didn't give two shits about the story? You didn't play through the story? You just wanted to dick around in the world?
Minecraft.
Yep. Most Grand Theft Auto games. I completed the Vice City story. I might have completed San Andreas, but that's it.
Just Cause 2.
Yeah. I played an hour of the story just to get far enough and then put 20 hours just dicking around with the environment.
Yeah.
I couldn't care just less cause, about the games.
We said this offline, but Just Cause, the only reason Just Cause 2 is even a decent game is because it's an open world game. Literally, if you were to segment Just Cause into like story missions and levels, the game is shit. The story is lackluster. The action is kind of eh, but oh my god, I can tie red explosive barrels to cows and shit? Fuck yes. That's the only thing I want to do in that game.
Or tether people to propane tanks, launch them into the air to take that guy skyrocketing and stuff.
Yes. It's just a fun sandbox. And I think the best open world games are really a combination of shit you care about that could be a regular game on its own and sandbox mechanics.
Absolutely. The big part of open world games is player choice, and not just as in regards like story, but like at all times you can decide what you want to do in the game because there are options. You have a sandbox to play in.
Yeah, and it's not options for the sake of options. It's options that you actually are inclined to do because they're genuinely fun.
Right, and I think it organically increases the playtime of the game. Like you can get your money's worth on a good open world game because you can play it so much because there's no hard start and stop point. Because even if you beat the main quest, there's still a million things you can do.
I mean, before this discussion, I was looking over this list. I was like, holy shit, I should load up GTA 5 again. That's a game I could go back to for years. Vice City is a game I'd go back to every couple years just because, I mean, 80s music, fast, awesome death trap supercars.
Yeah.
And awesome 80s music, right? I mean, did I mention awesome 80s music?
So, question for you guys.
I love GTA.
How often do you guys beat the open world games you like?
I would say about half of them.
Of all the ones I've probably
beat, under half.
Yeah, probably like 30%. I think
half of the ones I've played are Rockstar ones. Yeah, so.
I beat Prototype. I mean, Grand Theft Auto, I basically would play until I unlocked the whole map, then I'd stop with this quest, the story stuff.
Yep. I beat 3. 3 is the only GTA I've actually beat all the way.
I can't remember if I beat that one or not.
And then Prototype and 3, I never actually beat even freaking what we just talked about, Saints Row. I mean, I typically get to the point where I feel the game is fully unlocked, like you said, and then I just enjoy the environment if it's a really good game. Honestly, if I beat your open world game, it probably means it didn't need to be open world. Where there's not enough in the world to pull me away. Because I'll drop 50, 60 hours on a game without touching the story if the world's good.
I kind of agree. I kind of disagree in the case of Saints Row 3. Because the story missions were so fucking ridiculous and so hilarious all the time. You got into a luchador battle and you beat a man to death with sharks. Shark mallets. Mallets made out of sharks. Right? While Eye of the Tiger is playing in the background. That's basically like there's 5 of the greatest things in the world that's on that top 5 list. So I do want to talk about an open world game I absolutely hated that I got for free with a graphics card. NVIDIA decided to give me Watch Dogs, and I put about 3 hours into that before uninstalling the game. Holy shit, are open worlds buggy sometimes. Everyone's probably seen the Red Dead Redemption bird people, which are just hilarious. They're not game breaking, but in Watch Dogs, I was driving, right? I'm driving down the street trying to evade the cops. And first, my car just sinks into the road, just driving, rump, gone. Car gone. I'm standing on the street. My car is under the road somehow. I'm like, okay, that's fucking weird. Grab another car. I'm driving. And then all of a sudden, there's no bridge. It's not like, oh, bridge is out, you know, big flashing stuff. It's just, there's no bridge supposed to be there. So I drive and I fall into the sea, and then the bridge pops in above me. I'm like, oh, what the fuck? So after I get, you know, a mission or two in, and there's just bug after bug after bug in this game, I just decide to uninstall it. Developers, if you're going to make an open world game, please make sure it's functional before you release it. Watch Dogs was one of the most heavily marketed games I've ever seen, and it was by far one of the biggest pieces of bullshit on PC I've ever played.
Yeah.
Watch Dogs 2, I hear, is better. Yes. I have not played it, and I will not buy it.
Yeah, so that... Yeah, there's the whole bug aspect. The whole bug aspect brings up an entire developer. Bethesda. I mean, they're known for that shit, but
yeah.
I think that's pretty much all we have for open world, though. Do you guys have any little side bits you want to add?
I think they can be really fun if done right. It gives the player a lot of flexibility in how they want to play the game. It organically increases play time. But the developers have to be careful. I mean, they have to create a good world to be in.
I think developers can turn them into money pits.
Also true.
If you put too much money into a bad environment, you're fucked.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
I'll say that open worlds done right can be an amazing tool for world building, especially in a Western-style RPG. Take, you know, all of the new style Fallout games, for example. They are chock full of side quests that do nothing except build the world, introduce you to cool characters and concepts in the apocalypse setting that you're in. It's wonderful. Fallout New Vegas in particular was one of the best, you know, role-playing games, Western RPGs I've played in a very long time, specifically because the open world was so well done. But yeah, that's about all I have. With that, I think that's about the end of the podcast.
I think so. Would you guys like to hear a video game fact?
Yes. Yes, we would.
So I'm sure you've played Metal Gear Solid 3. I know I've played Metal Gear Solid 3. In Metal Gear Solid 3, there's a boss called The End, and you can defeat that boss by not playing the game. If you wait a week, or you can go in and change the date on the PlayStation, that boss will have died of old age in that time, and you can just stroll right on through the rest of the game without ever having to deal with him.
That is so damn cool.
Now, I didn't know that until I'd beat the game a long time ago.
On one hand, that's awesome. On the other hand, if you do that, you're skipping one of the best boss battles, and by far. Yes, that
was such a great boss battle.
By far the best sniper battle I've ever seen.
Ah, that game's full of that kind of shit. Fucking unplug the controller, plug it in the next port. God, I love the shit they do. Anyway, I think that's all we got for you this week at 72 Pin Connector. So we'd love to hear your questions, comments, remarks. Tell us what we're doing terribly wrong and how bad we're sucking at life, or tell us what you absolutely love. You can tweet at us at 72PCPodcast. You can send us an email at fanmail@72pinconnector.com. You can go check out any of our old videos, reviews, any gameplay clips, whatever you would like, at 72pinconnector on YouTube. Or you could always go to our website, 72pinconnector.com, and just see what we've been up to. Well, that's all we got for this week. So until next week, game on.
Praise the sun.
Yes, praise it.